Hello, welcome. My name is Karina, and I work for the admissions office at Rotterdam School of Management. I am originally from Mexico. Well, this session is about, it's a Q&A, so you can ask any questions you may have to our second current students. They will introduce themselves in a bit. But first of all, I would like to ask out of curiosity, please raise your hand if you already apply for IBA. Okay, thanks. And please raise your hand if you are planning to apply next year. Okay, it's more or less half and half, so it's good. Okay, so let's start. Mark, could you please introduce yourself?
Well, hello, everybody. I'm Mark. I am a second-year IBA student. So, yeah, I was in your position 1.5 years ago, and I did Dutch VWO. And any other VWO students in the room? Raise your hands. Yeah, yeah, quite a few. Well, feel free to ask me any questions. You got yeah, pretty much everything about IBA and student life, and I'm happy to answer.
Hello, everyone. My name's Anna. I'm a second year student too. I'm half French, half English, and I did the French baccalaureate with the OIB option. Did anybody else do the French baccalaureate or is doing it? Okay, quite a few. Nice. Nice to see.
Okay, hey, welcome everybody. I'm happy that you made it here. Welcome to Rotterdam. My name is Philip. I'm from Berlin in Germany. I did the German Abitur, and I'm just like the others in my second year. Any Germans here? Yeah? Okay, great. If you have any questions, also not related to the Abitur, but about IBA in general, we're happy to answer.
Yeah. Hi, everyone. My name is Luigi. I'm from Italy, and I did the International Baccalaureate. I think this is not working. Yeah, so is anybody doing IB as well in the room?
No.
All right, so if you have any questions, feel free to ask.
Okay, so let's start. Who wants to ask the first question? Oh, okay, we have a question here. The microphones will come to you. We have a question here.
In the front, here. Yeah.
In the front.
Hi, I'm Barbara. I'm here on behalf of my daughter, Victoria. My question is for Luigi. Luigi, how well did you feel you were prepared as an IB student to enter the IBA program?
Well, first of all, during my IB, I took economics higher level and business higher level, alongside with the English higher level. And I believe that economics prepared me very well for my first year, because we had both microeconomics and macroeconomics. So I already had the basis for that. While business gave me an overview of what IBA is as well, because it covered all the functional areas in business. And besides that, I took a math standard level, and that helped me a lot for my first year mathematics course.
Thank you. I was indeed curious about your mathematics. Victoria is taking as well extended level, higher level, sorry, economics, mm-hmm. standard level math. And since I saw a lot of math all over the place, I thought, how well would she be prepared for this?
I didn't get a too high score in math SL. I got a 5. So I think it's very doable. And I managed to get a 10 here. So I think Math SL prepares you very well for the first year mathematics, at least.
Yeah, maybe we can, because I know that some students, not only IB students, but in general students, are worried about the math level at IBA. So maybe you all can tell us something about how you experience math at IBA.
Sure. Well, how I experienced it myself, I found it personally quite difficult. I'm really bad at maths, to be honest. It took me quite some effort to pass according to the requirements in high school. So I managed to get like 7.0 or 7.1. And I did mathematics A, to be clear. But yeah, when you start IBA, for me, it was quite difficult. But the good thing is that they start from zero. I think you guys all agree. They start literally from scratch. Like, it starts really easy, like 5x plus 3 equals 8. What is X? It's stuff like that. So it's pretty basic. And it, of course, it goes up real quick. And yeah, so in the end, it's all pretty doable. Just if you put in the effort, it's fine. So if you're in a position like I was with mathematics A and you're not very good at maths, just don't worry. As long as you meet the requirements, then your maths level is good enough.
Yeah, for me, I did the scientific course. So in France, you can do economics or scientifics or literature mainly. So I was prepared in terms of maths, so it was fine. The hardest part was just the value was in English. So sometimes the thinking process is kind of hard. You know, you think, oh yeah, X, okay, this is this. But you get used to it and there's tutors to help, so that's something I should advise. If you're bad at maths, well, there's help at uni for that.
I generally like quantitative subjects, but I, with my German Abitur, took a regular course in math. So for the German, it's a Grundkurs, and that prepared me sufficiently for the math that is required in IBA. And one other thing that the university does that helped me, and maybe also you guys, is that in quantitative subjects, you usually have a lecture and then also a workshop. And for example, in math, in the first year, we had regular weekly bonus tests. Which you did with a little bit of preparation in order to earn a bonus point in the exam. But it's not only for the bonus point that you do it, it's actually a continuous preparation. So in the end, if you kind of keep up with what the university gives you, then it's doable, I think, and you're not stuck with a lot of things before the exam.
Okay, thank you. Another question? We have a question here.
Hi, I'm Michelle, and I have a question for Luigi as well. I'm taking IB, and I'm taking studies, and I wonder how well that's seen, or if there's any chance of getting accepted, and what kind of grade you need to get for that, as well as having to take an entrance exam, I heard.
Yeah, exactly. I think for IB, the minimum requirement was standard level.
Yeah.
But for studies, you need to take an entrance exam. I think it's doable. Well, for me, SL prepared me very well, I believe, because it went over all the concepts, all the theories, most of the theories that we had in this course as well. But as Philip said, we actually have a lot of workshops.
Okay.
So workshops are actually taught by other fellow students. So you can communicate with them, because in a lecture room, the professor has 500 students, more than 500 students, while in workshops, you can actually ask for personal feedback on your assignments, or if you have any difficulties, you can just talk to them.
So you don't think that with having studies as a background, it would be an issue to get into IBA?
So, sorry to interrupt. If you have, if you are doing math studies at IBA, you need a grade of 6 to be able to take the math entrance exam. In our experience, students don't, not the majority pass this exam. Of course, you can study a lot and prepare very well, and we have the guide on the website. If you pass it, then you will be able to cope with, because you will be eligible, so you will be able to cope with the math exam.
Okay, thank you.
No problem. Yes.
Hello, I'm Andrew. I'm here with my daughter from France. I've got a question for perhaps all four of you. In the presentation before, we saw that there are about 15 hours of lessons a week, and then was it 25 of group work and your own personal work? Could you give us your take on that? Is that correct? Is it harder than that? Obviously, it depends on each of you, but is that about right? And also, following on a bit from the maths, and if you are in difficulty, I think, Anna, you mentioned there are tutors you can go to. Do each of you have an assigned tutor who can help you, meet you once a week or once a fortnight to iron out any problems?
I'll start answering for the maths. In the workshops, you're in small groups, so you can ask questions to the second-year student that's giving you the workshop. But you can also try to find a tutor, so second years do that. And there's also crash courses, so associations that help, and you can take classes there extra onto the lectures and workshops. So that's for the maths. And then the workload, It really depends on the trimester. Some trimesters you spend a lot of time in the lectures and there's actually 15 hours of lectures. And sometimes there's less and you work on your own. Everyone's different. For me, I need to work every week and read the chapter for the lecture, etc. I know other people work differently. So it's all about how you deal with it. What do you guys think?
I'm sorry.
Yeah. For the tutor question that you asked, one thing that I noticed, and I thought at first, oh, it won't be possible to talk to a professor if there's such a big lecture. For example, we had a finance course last year, and it was very different because the professor actually dedicated a whole day for us to come to his office and ask questions. So yes, you can ask your tutor in a workshop because it's a small size. It's usually 30 students, but you can also approach the professor. And for the workload, I think it's really subjective. So it depends on what type of student and how you study. For me, I try to do things regularly, so I don't have to lock myself into the library 2 weeks before the exams. And I think if you do that, it's actually really manageable. And yeah, I think the approximation on the slides is realistic.
Mark, you're...
Well, that's yeah, pretty much it. I think I can agree with that. For some subjects, you find them more difficult, so of course you're going to spend more time on it. But on average, I think it's pretty accurate, the 25 hours, besides the lessons, the contact hours that you're going to be at uni.
Could I just follow through very quickly? How often are you all in the same amphitheater, 550 for a course?
It depends. It's usually for pretty much all the subjects you have big lectures that are in rooms like these, this one for example, and they have workshops on the side where you're divided in smaller groups and it's easier to approach your professor and ask questions or your tutor. I think for every subject you have like 4 to 5 every trimester, you have at least one big lecture a week. And for some of the subjects that are a bit more intense, so for example, we have applied business methods, and that's like statistics. It's pretty difficult, so we have two big lectures, and besides that, also a workshop. But usually it's one lecture and one workshop, right?
Yeah, so a regular day would have one lecture, usually in the morning or at 1, and a workshop or just one lecture. It depends on the trimester. Some trimesters we actually have like a 3-day weekend, which is great if you want to go home or go on a trip. But yeah, a regular day you would meet once and then you see everyone around on campus or in the library.
There's also a few courses that actually don't have lectures regularly. Mm-hmm. So for example, I don't know if you've been to the first session, the SBP course, the Strategic Business Plan, or now we're doing technology management. It's based off team projects, so you work in a group with other students. So you don't necessarily have lectures for all courses. There's a few exceptions, which is actually something I like a lot about IBA as well, because it has quite some practical aspects.
Thank you.
Louis, would you like to tell something about how many hours you study per week?
Sure. I think at university, what you really learn is how to manage your time. So you start exploring how to actually manage your workload. So for instance, Anna and Philip said that they prefer to do it weekly, but I actually, I'm one of the guys who locked myself in the library for 2 weeks before the exam. So because for me, it's better. I go to the lectures. I don't do the readings at home, let's say. But then when I go through it 2 weeks before the exam, it works for me. I tested a lot during my first trimester with different subjects. And now I think I found my study method.
So you work under pressure.
Yeah.
Okay. Another question. We have a question here. From this side, we have questions so that the microphone can already go to you. So let's start with this question. Yes.
Yeah, I have a question for the Dutch student. Mm-hmm. Because, how do you think you have set yourself apart from like other Dutch students who have applied for IBA?
In my case, I'm a bit different from most of my Dutch counterparts because I started studying right after high school and I did economics and law also here at Erasmus. But yeah, I didn't really like it, so I quit after a year and I started backpacking. And I did that for quite a while. So that's, yeah, I guess what sets me apart in the sense that I had my international experience, but I also have a good friend and he didn't have the international experience. So his international experience was going to France with his parents every summer. It sounds funny, but some people don't have the financial means. And the way he gained his extra experience was through things with school. Like they went on an exchange for a week, and I think Bas in the previous presentation was talking about the Model United Nations. Those are all things that can set you apart. So if you don't have the international experience or don't have the means to gain the international experience, those are things that can make you stand out from other high school students.
Okay, thank you.
No worries.
The other question was here, right? Yes, here, please.
Hi, my name's Emily, and I am completing high school in Chicago. So I'm wondering how an American high school education would integrate. And it's kind of based towards all of you since you're all from Europe, and I know that the majority of Rotterdam will be from Europe, but I was wondering if any of you have information about how America would integrate.
I attended an international boarding school in New York, so it's not very similar to the typical American high school, I believe. But I would say the main difference between Europe and America is you're not gonna get the college town, let's say. I mean, Erasmus University is very big. It has around 25,000 students. But you get a lot of extracurricular activities. So instead of fraternities or sororities, which there are those as well, but you have a lot of student organizations. For instance, I'm part of the local board of the Erasmus Student Network. Last year, I was an active member at the Erasmus Center for Entrepreneurship. So you actually find a lot of activities based on your interest, because I want to start my own business at one point. So that's why I went for entrepreneurship. But if you're into marketing, there's the Marketing Association. If you like finance, there's also like BNR Burs, which is an investment group. So for you, it will be very easy to integrate, I believe, as an international student, because you will find people who have the same mindset as you, as yours.
For academics specifically, one of you stated in an earlier question how math starts pretty basic. Would that be similar in all areas, where if you don't have the experience that maybe a European has in a more specialized on an exam or a final exam, would that be okay in integration?
I think you don't really need specific academic background for IBA, because it covers, as I already said, all areas of business. So it's a broad study, so I don't think you will have any difficulties in integrating in the European education system.
Okay, thank you.
Maybe also quickly to add to that, usually maybe some students, for example, Dutch students who took economics, I noticed that they, in the first weeks, have maybe a little advantage because they covered some of the topics, but that's for the first couple of weeks. After that, it's new material for everybody, so maybe you have a little head start, but it's not really a big advantage. And in general, there's this, I don't know, IBA feel. We kind of consider ourselves a big family. It's not that competitive that one goes against the other. We are, for example, have a Facebook group where files and tips are shared. We help each other. So it's, from a social side, very easy to integrate because everybody's very open, I would say.
Yeah, we can put you in contact with some students from the US. If you want, talk to me afterwards and they can tell you their own experience. And a colleague from our admissions team is from the US. You can also ask her, she's at the stand. Okay, another question. Yes. Well, let's start here and then here. Yes.
Hi. I'm Tommaso, I'm from Italy, so I have a question for Luigi. I come from Liceo Scientifico, I don't know if you know it, so do you think I'm going to be able to catch up with the economic part, because we don't study economics in our school, in our high school, so do you think I'm going to be able to catch up with the new subject, or I need some preparation or something?
Well, I actually started with Liceo Scientifico as well. So I did my first 3 years in Italy, and then I moved to the US to finish high school with the IB. As I already said, IB helped me with the basics of economics, but I'm pretty sure it's accessible for you as well with a scientific background, let's say. It's nothing extremely hard. It will be just different for you at the beginning because you've never heard of these concepts, maybe, since we don't really have that course in Italy. But no, it's absolutely doable.
Roberta, you did Liceo Scientifico, right?
I did.
Would you like to also?
Yes. In my experience, it was absolutely doable, as Luigi said, especially because Liceo Scientifico, at least from what I experienced, gave us a very good basis in mathematics, which is particularly important for IBA to then apply it to the economics subject. So I would say don't worry about it at all.
Okay, thank you. Yes, the question here, right? Yes.
Hi, I'm Rima from the Netherlands, and I was wondering if you're not able to get a 7 in the fifth year of VWO, if there are any chances to get in, or if you should just not apply at all.
I will reply to this one because it's an admissions question. So you will be ranked. And then, for example, if there are other students that have a higher grade, but it's not only the grades that count, but if you attended the presentation, were you here? Well, it was explained how they make the ranking. So it's your motivation and the grades and your complete profile, and then they will rank. And the best 575 will receive an offer, and then it will go like this. So it all depends on the others, you know. You will be ranked.
Okay, thank you.
So that means that if you have below 7 on average, you get put in a lower tie, right?
Exactly.
Lower tier.
Yes, I have a question here, and the microphone is right here. Yes, please.
Hello, I'm from Germany, and I'd like to know how freely you can order your timetable and how close to school the system is.
Sorry, can you repeat the second part of the question?
How close to school is the system and the timetable? At university here.
One difference to Germany is that you can't really arrange the time slots when you take your lectures or workshops yourself. It's pretty much set. I believe that's a little different in Germany, that you can maybe move some of your courses. And compared to Germany, from what I also understand from my friends, it's actually a little bit more closer to school here than in Germany, where you have to arrange registrations and for exams, for example, by yourself. IBA is a very broad program, and that's why basically your curriculum is quite set for you, which doesn't necessarily leave room for specialization, but you can then specialize in a field in your master's studies. But the curriculum is quite set. But the difference to school, like it was already mentioned, is that you basically have to learn to organize yourself and live away from home.
Okay, thank you.
There's another question here. Yes, and in the meantime, okay.
Hello, I'm Isabella from Germany, and I just wanted to ask you what the average NC is like here.
Yeah, that's actually one thing I very much like about Rotterdam, and it surprised me a little bit when I came here for the open day, because in Germany you're used to having just numerous Klausus, and if you meet the grade, you're in. If not, you don't have a chance. And that's one thing that I like very much, that the university takes the effort to go through applications, read individual motivations and see if you fit to this program. In general, you should have an average grade of 1.8. I think that's the requirement, and for math and English, around 10 points.
Yeah.
But yeah, like I said, the grades for those who didn't attend count for 50% of the admission, and the rest of the 50%, so 25 each, is split among your CV, your international background, as well as your motivation. So that's a little different to Germany. Yeah.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Hi, my name is Leo, I'm from France. I had a question for you guys concerning the price of living here in the Netherlands. I was just wondering, how much euros a month do you think is necessary to live in the, like, fairly?
Okay, I'll be honest. I think we live in Kralingen, which is the posh area, kind of Rotterdam, so it's higher prices here. For my first year, I lived in Hatte, the building on campus, so it's 500 euros per month for the rent. And then my parents give me 450 euros, and for me, that's fine. I think you spend your money as you want to. Like, I know people that spend way more and way less, but I think that's a good estimate.
I think there's actually online, there's a page that explains how much money approximately you spend on books, on food, and on rent, but I would have to look to Karina. You know that probably?
Yeah.
If that page is there, I think there was a page.
Yeah, there was a page. At least for Aya, there was a page giving you an estimate of how much money you would need. So look that up.
Yeah, I think it was approximately 1,000 euros, but that's on the low side, I think.
1,000. Yeah.
Depends what you do.
I need a little bit more.
Okay. Yes, there is another question here. Questions from this side. The microphone can already go there, but we are going to start with, yes.
Hello, my name is Daria. I did my school education in Ukraine, and now I'm doing an on-campus foundation program in Amsterdam. So there are minimum grades which you need to obtain in order to be considered for admission for the program. But what grades do you need to gain competitive advantage? Now I'm talking about IELTS grade and MAS grade, and IELTS grade in the IELTS system and MAS grade in percentage system. Thank you.
All right. You mean like which grade you need to have in the IELTS to have a competitive advantage in the course?
And also in maths, but not in the course, I mean in admission process. So with what grade do you need to have in order to be accepted?
No, well, like we mentioned, it's a ranking, so you will get a score for your grades, you will get a score on your motivation, and then we will make a ranking. So it's not like we have for admissions IELTS 6, I think, for IBA. Yes?
I didn't do 6. The IELTS.
And that's like for eligibility. But it's not that if you have the highest possible grade in IELTS, you will have a competitive advantage. We look at everything.
Yeah, but what kind of with what kind of grade people are usually accepted? Like 7, 8, or like?
You mean in the IELTS?
Yeah, in the IELTS, just as usual.
So the IELTS is 6, I think, for IBA, because 6.5 is for master, right? Adri, 6? Yes, 6. With a 6, you have fulfilled the requirement of a language.
And what about MAS? So like, people can be accepted for the program like as usual, so maybe like previous year, people who were accepted previous year, so what grade they had, like on average for math in percentage?
For mathematics, you mean?
Yeah.
So for the Dutch, diploma is a 7. So with that, you are eligible for the program, because if you will have lower than that, then you will be ranked at the end. But then other things also are important, like your motivation, because you will also get a grade for that. Also, the higher your grades, the more points you will get.
Okay, yeah? Thank you.
No problem.
Hello, I'm Bente from the Netherlands, and I wondered what is the main difference between international business administration and international business and languages?
Mm-hmm. International business administration and international business and languages.
Ooh. I'm not familiar with international business and languages. Is that also a university program?
Yeah, I thought it was in Maastricht, and yeah, also it's a IBA, but
I'm not familiar with that program, so I could answer it, but it's going to be a very wrong answer then probably, so I'd rather not
maybe
do that.
Maybe the best you can do is ask, so go to Maastricht and ask the current students what the prize, so look at the curriculum and also ask them like, what do they do in languages, what kind of, what do that mean, what does that mean? And also just compare the curriculums, because IBA, International Business Administration, is business. You, of course, can learn other languages at the Erasmus Center, but just compare the curriculums and talk to students from both programs.
Okay, thank you.
No problem. Okay, a question here.
I have a question for Anna. I'm also French and British. I'm doing the French baccalaureate, and I'm in the OIB system. But I'm still hesitating. I know there's quite a rare option, and I wanted to know, with your personal experience, the advantages of doing OIB and also maybe the advantages of not doing OIB.
Doing OIB helped me with the English level and being able to have a good English writing. So I like that, and also I think because it's additional work, it gives you a way of working that will work well here, and you'll be more efficient. So that's what I gained from OIB. I guess because you're also English, your English is good, so that's not going to change anything. What did you want to know else?
I know that the OIB is quite a rare option, and maybe like the advantages of not doing the OIB and just doing like the normal French baccalaureate.
I don't think there are any advantages of not doing it, because it's additional to the French baccalaureate. So if you do it, it's good. It's a better thing to do it. As I said, I do think it'll have an impact on your admission. So take that into consideration and talk about it, because I'm sure you've done Model United Nations and any projects like that that can really help you. Yeah? Did I answer your question? Yeah? Okay, good.
Okay, before we go to the next question, because I think you might have some questions about admissions in case you missed the previous presentation. So you can see here the slide of how it's calculated. So your grades will count for 50%, your curriculum for 25%, and the answers to the motivation questions for 25%. And then we will calculate the score, and the score will determine your place in the ranking. And with a grade below 7 for mathematics, you will be in the lowest tier. And then from 1 to 575, they will be selected in the ranking. And then it will move, like for example, if some people don't accept their offer, then other people from 575 onwards will get a place. Do you have any other questions about the admissions? Okay, I see. Various questions about admissions. Yes, let's start. Okay, let's start here.
I got a question about the internships.
Let's just because I just explained admissions. Any questions about admissions? Okay, let's start here then.
How many applications do you get per year in general?
So this is the first year that we worked with this system, the numerus fixus. So we got submitted, we got 1,500, about 1,500.
Okay, thank you.
The deadline was 2 days ago. Okay. Another question? Yes, here. Can the microphone can already go? Uh-huh.
Yeah, but yes. it's not about admissions. So.
No, just about admissions, so that we finish with that slide, because, yes. Okay.
Well, I was wondering about the grades, because I'm from the Dutch VWO, but we have an 8, for example, for mathematics. How much points do you get extra, like, to the 7 of mathematics?
No, that... so we will. The admissions committee will decide that, if you have a higher than.
Yeah, thank you.
Another question about admissions.
Does it make any difference if you do mathematics A or B in the grade you have to get?
In the grade you have to get?
Yeah, you have to get a 7 to get in.
No, it's 7.0 for both, or for either. So if you do mathematics A, you need 7.0, and for mathematics B, also 7.0.
Yeah, if you have very specific questions, also remember that at the stand we have the admissions team, so then you can ask all the admission specific questions there. And then now we can continue with them because we have them here at the stage. Okay.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Yes, a question here.
Hi. My name is Felipe, and I was wondering how the three of you that did not complete the Dutch education got by in Rotterdam without speaking any Dutch before coming here.
I still don't speak a lot of Dutch in the end, I have to admit. It's a beautiful language, that's true. I'm just bad at languages. No, actually, it's really impressive in this country. I mean, I come from France, nothing against France, but we're not that good at languages. And here, it's really impressive. I mean, the lady in the supermarket will speak to you in English, the children in the street will speak to you in English. So, to me, there are no problems with not speaking Dutch, but you should learn for your own knowledge.
Yeah, I also feel like if Dutch people notice that you're foreign, they kind of want to show off a little bit that they know English really well. So, yeah. I unfortunately also don't know Dutch yet, but maybe that's a future plan.
Yeah, same for me. I don't speak any Dutch, but I think Rotterdam is a very international city. It's dynamic. There are a lot of internationals. As Anna said, at a supermarket, they speak you in Dutch. On campus, in English, sorry. Yeah, and on campus as well. When you go out, everything in English. So I don't need Dutch, although I do plan on studying to learn some Dutch now.
Okay, thank you.
Yes, question here. There are
two questions maybe that the parents would typically ask. One is lodging. Where do you sleep? I'm hearing it's very difficult to find lodging in Rotterdam. So that's one question. Second question is, what is the success rate? You started with 750. Is it 25%? Is it 50%? Is it after the first year?
570. Yeah, we start with that. Okay, so where do you live? I think you already mentioned, right, that you live in Kralingen.
Yeah. I live like 2 minutes away by bike. I suggest for the first year living on campus is really nice. So if you can try and live in Hatta, the building on campus, I would really advise that for the first year. And then once you get to know the city, you can try and find somewhere for the next year. What do you guys do?
I lived not on campus on my first year. I lived in an own little studio by myself. Now I live with a really good Italian friend that I met during the first year. I think that's what many people do, that then in the second year they have friends move together with them. But like Anna said, I think a big advantage of living on campus is that you are already right next to fellow students, so you kind of forced to do things with each other. That's definitely nice. And for the success rate, I believe it's around 85% that go to the second year. So quite high rate. And those 15% are not necessarily only due to failures, but also some people might not think that IBA is something that they like, so they drop out.
Actually, we just got the results because we analyzed the data from the year that we started with the nominalis normal. So if you don't pass your first year in 1 year, then you have to leave the university. And so we analyzed all the data, and we saw that there was an increase in success, especially for the Dutch and for the Europeans. So now that we have these, there are more students that pass the first year in 1 year. For the non-Europeans, it's slightly a little bit less, but I think it also has to do with the fact that many of them is their first experience by themselves here. So that might be something. But like Philip said, it's also sometimes that they realize business is not what they were looking for. Okay, we have time for one more question. Here, okay.
I got the question about the internships. I was wondering how many internships you were able to do, or if you're able to do internships at all.
Like a lot. it's up to you. It's something that you have to arrange yourself. Of course, the university can offer you support. So they have, I lost the name, what's it called again?
Career Services,
and they can help you and give you feedback on your CV or your cover letter and advise you on how to do all that. And then there's also, I think, a society called Integrant, but they're mainly focused on internships in the Netherlands, I think also for Dutch students. But yeah, it's something that you have to arrange yourself. So you have to pretty much, I think there are some requirements that you have to fulfill regarding your internship. But you have to search for it yourself, so it can be everywhere on the world and whatever you like, as long as it is within those requirements.
Yeah. You can do.
Okay, So it is not inside the program.
It's in the third year. You can do for the first trimester. You can do an internship, but I'm, for example, going on exchange, and I did an internship during the summer. So it's you can also do it during your own time if you don't want to go through the university.
Yeah, but there is time scheduled for the internship. It's in the first trimester of the third year.
Okay, thank you.
No worries.
Yes, if you have more questions, we will be at the stand until 4. And also, we have a Facebook app where you can find our current students and you can ask any other question. Thank you very much for coming to this session.